Wow. Hallelujah. Do you believe that? Jesus, Messiah, Lord of all, has come to establish salvation, the hope of the nations here on this earth. Emmanuel, God with us, dwelling here in our midst. Is he dwelling in your hearts today? Is there room in his heart for you today? We're going to hear a bit more about that a little bit later on. I want to welcome each and every one of you here today as well. What a blessing it is to see you. We're grateful that you are here and that that you're worshiping with us. I pray that your heart is prepared for a time of continued worship as we meditate and take in and soak in the words of the Almighty One, Almighty God. Inspired words of God, gifted to you and me, standing through the course of all the ages, a firm foundation that cannot be shaken. Wow! For you, for me, here today, that's good news of great joy. That's reason to sing joy to the world. I would echo the words of Lannan too in his opening remarks and comments. Thank you so very much for all of you who participated and were a part of in whatever shape or form you were attached to it on Wednesday evening through our little tradition that we've began here a few years ago and going out through our neighborhood and caroling and singing the hope of Christmas, about the hope of Christmas. Hope has a name, right? His name, its name is Jesus, the gift of God given to us. And while an experience like that may open our eyes to things that we've never seen or heard before, I thank God for his protection as we roam the streets, and I pray that indeed his Spirit will continue to move, just as was already mentioned, that whatever seed may have been planted, that God's Spirit would carry forth and bring that into life, that it might also bear seed someday. Today we're going to take a little different approach to our message, one that it would initially cause you to ruffle your feathers just a bit as you hear these words spoken to you, but I would ask today that as we carry out our time of worship here and opening up God's Word, that perhaps you don't go to particular texts today, but through the course of the sermon here, through the course of the message here today, you will see many different verses and scriptures listed on the overhead above. I would just ask that today you just tune your hearts into the words that are spoken from God's Word, and that you would have a pen and paper ready and handy. And through these verses, as these verses appear on the PowerPoint, as they scroll through our time of meditation here today, that you jot these references down. And then just as some of you may be in the practice of here another week or two when your children are on vacation break and they say, "Mom, I'm so bored, what should I do?" And you have to come up with something for them to do to occupy their time. This isn't just a meaningless task to occupy your time, but take note of these verses. And in the next days, weeks, months, perhaps even years, reference back to these verses that describe the gift that has been given to us. Emmanuel, God with us, to dwell in our hearts today, so that in a way that you can use in the days, weeks, months, and years ahead, that what is heard in your mind, what registers in your mind, is also believed in your heart. Not a new thought to many of you who are here for Sunday school, but I pray that today that could become a very true reality within each and every one of us. So today, just listen in and jot these references down as we scan across them. And be like the Bereans. See if what you hear is really true. The Bible tells us in Matthew chapter 1, in the days of Caesar Augustus, a census and a taxation was decreed throughout all the Roman Empire, that all the people should return to their own towns to be registered. Luke 2 says this, "And because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. He traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, to whom he was engaged, who was now also expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no lodging available for them in the inn. And they named their son Jesus, just as the angel had told them. Matthew 1. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophets. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. So the stage has been set. And for those of us who have the privilege of living in 2023 on this December 17th morning, we have the privilege of knowing what the end of the book says. The process of getting to the end and understanding the end is up to us then, isn't it? The determination of where we fit into that ending story, of how that last scene of the book unfolds, is all dependent on you and me, right here, right now, in the way that we deal with the gift that has been given from Almighty God to us, Emmanuel, God with us. We're going to cover a lot of different places, a lot of different ground this morning. And I pray by the end, we can put it all together in a package that makes sense, so that just as the words that we sang on the board this morning, on the wall this morning, we sang of those glorious truths that perhaps for the first time, for the very first Christmas, you can sing these words from a platform of believing and understanding and living in a way that you never have before. So the stage has been set. Emmanuel, God with us, is right here, dwelling in our midst. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you in the blessed and precious name of the Savior of the world, Christ Jesus, the Messiah, the rescuer of our souls, the one who paid the ransom for the penalty that we, oh my, so rich and high. So deep and dark was the place of our lives and our souls and our hearts, and you reached down in the pits of our despair and you offered us a hand of rescue, a place of redemption, a gift of forgiveness. Oh, how amazing and rich is that love, that you, my King, would die for me. Heavenly Father, today I pray that through your Spirit's anointing, your word would speak forth into our hearts and minds in a way that would connect the two, bringing us to a place where our hearts are fully opened, open perhaps in a way that they have never been before, to allow you to dwell within us in a way that you never have before. God, open our eyes to that place of understanding. Make the book come alive to us and us alive to it. Help us to embrace this blessed gift of Christmas, Jesus, in a way that we never have before. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Originally designed as a gift of peace and power, symbolizing the forging of an alliance between Russia and Prussian empires against Sweden, it was constructed within the confines of a place like this, Catherine's Palace, in what is now the St. Petersburg region of Russia. It took approximately 10 years to construct, and in its day was labeled the eighth wonder of the world. It is called the Amber Room. The Amber Room was made of a gemstone, largely of the gemstone, anybody guess? Oh, come on. Amber. It's not a trick question. Amber. Amber forms from a resin that drips from a particular conifer tree, from the bark of a specific type of conifer tree. And as this resin begins to harden, it sometimes traps insects or other plant matter within it as it begins to harden and crust over, making it all the more valuable. If you find a stone of amber with something like this that you see on the board above you, it increases its worth and value. The Amber Room was developed and built within the confines of Catherine's palace. Its original design was approximately 180 square feet, consisting of nearly six tons of amber and other special treasures of the region. Modern-day gem and treasure appraisers estimate the Amber Room's worth in today's dollar value somewhere around the ballpark of $500 million. The Amber Room was one of the world's most glamorous symbols of peace. But on June 22, 1941, 3 million Nazi soldiers pushed into the Soviet Union and surrounded St. Petersburg during World War II. With this invasion came an attack on Catherine's palace. And stolen out of the palace was the wonders and treasures of the Amber Room, which have never been seen since. Quests have been made in hundreds of different locations to find this lost treasure that was once described as the Amber Room. But every single one of these quests, every single one of these places of hopeful discovery have turned up empty. Every single location have turned up empty. Visitors to the palace today find themselves standing in a room that is only a replica of the real Amber Room. Constructed in 2003, the Amber Room replica that you find within the palace today is only a model. It's not the real thing. It does not contain the same worth, does not contain the same value, it does not carry the same meaning or the same significance. The room is actually empty of furnishings. Only in the room is found this, an easel with a cardboard display that tells the story of the lost wonder that once occupied that place. Friends, some 2,000 years ago, a different kind of gift was introduced into the world. This gift was not given to a particular country or region, but to all of humanity. This gift was also a symbol of peace and power, but its peace and power were of insurpassable grandeur. It was formed and forged an alliance not between two nations, but it formed the ultimate alliance of mankind between its creator and the created. The gift bonded God and man, uniting them together against the forces of Satan's works of darkness. This gift was also designed to dwell within a room, but not a room inside of a palace made with bricks, stones, and wood, but inside the room of a human being's heart. The gift was not meant to be confined to a specific amount of square footage, but was meant to dwell in the immeasurable places of men and women's hearts, spanning far and wide, never meant to be hidden behind walls, bars, doors, or shutters. The gift was not meant to be weighed or valued in pounds or pesos, dollars, or cents, nor can it be, because it contains eternal value, a value that is worth more than all the world's finest gold, gems, and riches combined. This gift cannot be crushed. It cannot be shaken. It cannot be cracked. It cannot be molded. It cannot be stolen. It cannot be bought. It cannot be earned. It cannot be traded. And it can never compare to man's demands, desires, or dreams. It surpasses them all. Upon this gift, all of the world exists. It is by this gift, through this gift, and for this gift that the entire universe was made and is sustained. This gift is incomparable to anything in all the world. It cannot be matched by any rival. It is immovable, imperishable, indestructible. Yet sadly, Christmas after Christmas, year after year, men and women, boys and girls, refuse to accept this gift. They refuse to make it the sure and steadfast foundation of their souls for which it was designed to be. This gift has a name. It is the radiance of Almighty God, the glory of God, the exact imprint of His character and nature. Through this gift, the entire universe exists and is upheld by the word of its power. His name is Jesus. This gift is awesome in every form and fashion of the word. He has offered to every single one of us this gift. He has asked each and every one of us to allow this gift to dwell in the room of our hearts. But somewhere in the days of our lives, that room in our hearts where that priceless, precious gift was meant to dwell came under attack, didn't it? It came under an invading army, didn't it? An army called evil, an enemy called darkness crept into that heart. And just as happened in St. Petersburg in World War II, we of our own doings and of our own power, we were unprepared for this onslaught, unequipped by our own might to fight back. We were not strong enough on our own. We didn't have enough time to call for reinforcements. And now that special room in our hearts stands empty. Just like they've tried to do with the treasures of the Amber Room, men and women, boys and girls have searched high and low, trying to find some lost treasure to fill that void of emptiness in the room of their hearts. We've made quests and explorations in countless ways and places, trying to replicate, trying to design our own, trying to build our own treasure to occupy that empty room, to fill its place. But none can fill the place in our hearts like the gift named Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. For it was that exact place that He desires to dwell. Others of us here we've intentionally, by our own doings, we've let the enemy forces invade that room in our hearts so many times, it is absolutely impossible to imagine anything ever occupying that room in our hearts again, other than the dismal darkness that we find there today. As we look upon the ruins that have been left from these countless attacks, these countless onslaughts, we see only the pain and the shame, the heartache and the trauma. We see no place for a treasure to dwell, certainly not one of infinite value and worth. Others of us have come to Christmas again this year, just the same as we've done for so many before it. We take the tour, looking at the lights, adoring the attractions, the glitz and the glamour, and for a moment or two, it brings a smile to our face. But the peace and the pleasantness of those moments, they're fleeting. And because of those fleeting moments, we soon discover that we stand once again in the middle of an empty room. For years and years and years, some of you within listening distance have been coming to Christmas through the motions, taking in the motions, singing the songs, smiling the smiles, exchanging the gifts, eating the treats, enjoying the candy. But inside that room of your heart is only an easel with a cardboard plaque that tells the story of what could have, would have, should have been. Just as you've done many years before, you are about to embark on a brand new year, and you've begun to already set some goals, dreams, and ambitions. But inside that room of your heart, empty again this year. Some of you have done this unfulfilling cycle so many times, you truly believe that all hope of ever experiencing anything different is probably gone. The treasure has been lost forever. But behold, today in the city of Goshen, Indiana, there is good news of great joy for all the people. For unto us has been given a Savior, Christ Jesus is His name, Emmanuel, the gift of God dwelling within us. Friends, do you believe that today? Wow, that is an amazing indescribable gift. The treasure that turns mourning into dancing. The treasure that transforms ashes into beauty. The treasure that makes the weak strong. The treasure that turns captives into conquerors. The treasure that turns defeats into victories. The treasure that turns failures into triumphs. Jesus is his name, and he wants to dwell within the room of your hearts. Have you made room for him this year? The gift's name is Jesus. Will he find room in your heart? No matter how many years you thought he was gone, no matter how long you have been searching, today you can know that the gift is here. The gift isn't gone forever. The treasure hasn't been lost or stolen. The gift is here. The Spirit of Christ Jesus is here. He is moving in our midst, and he seeks to dwell within the hearts of each and every one of us, as he's done never, as perhaps you've never allowed him to do before. So this year I plead with you, don't take the tour once again and find at the end emptiness. Don't let another Christmas go by with discontentment, fear, sorrow, shame, or pain, keeping that room in your hearts cold and hollow, leaving the gift, as Mary and Joseph had to do, standing on the outside of the dwelling place. There's no room for you in here. Go find somewhere else to dwell. Don't despise and reject this gift this time. Ask him, receive him into that dwelling place in your heart. Don't hide your face from him. Don't demean him. Don't dishonor the gift that you have been offered. The gift is truly, truly has been acquainted with all of your griefs and sorrows. He is associated with your pain. He knows what your shame looks like. The gift's name is Jesus. And he seeks to illuminate every single path that you travel down. Every step that you take, he desires to light the way and show you a brighter day. He increases joy. He makes our hearts glad again. He is the mighty fortress. He is high and lifted up above all other things, above all other powers, above all other dominions and domains. His rule and reign of justice and righteousness shall never end. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his reign and rule, there shall be no end. Wow! Who shall do this? How shall we know this? The zeal of the Lord shall accomplish this. A sleeping town they did not know. Don't be caught sleeping as those in Bethlehem were that wondrous night. From this moment on, not one single one of us can ever claim ignorance as a valid defense. None of us can claim the excuses that we used yesterday, that we're too busy today with things, we're too tired or weak, even doing the wonderful things that we're a part of, to really know and understand. And it's not really our fault that we've missed him again this year. For while you may wish that this gift would come in some other way, or you may have expected him to show up in some other way, today that gift is chosen and precious in the sight of God. And he desires to dwell within your very presence, within the room of your heart. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that the old you might die to sin and live to righteousness today. By his wounds, your hearts can be healed. For you were straying like sheep at one time, but now you have the opportunity to return to the shepherd, the overseer of your souls. You who were once dead in your trespasses and sins, in which we once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, repeating the empty cycle over and over and over and over again for some of us. Among us, a great light has dawned, and we who once walked around in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and mind, who were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind, but God, rich in mercy, because of the great love which he loved us, even when we were dead, even in those repeating cycles of emptiness, he made us, created us, allowed us to experience togetherness with Jesus. By grace you have been saved and you have been raised up with him, seated with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. The gift is here. Hope has a name, Christ Jesus. It is he. He gives power to the faint. To him who has no might, he increases strength. Those who are weak and weary, those who become exhausted from the journey, he will renew their strength. He will mount them up and cause them to soar like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Is there room in your hearts for him this year? Similar to the awesome awe and wonder that exploded into the lives of those shepherds and propelled them to respond to the glorious message of the gift of the Savior. Today, by placing the gift of the Savior within the room of your heart, you can also experience an awesome awe and wonder. With this gift, you become part of a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into marvelous light. Has that been the testimony of the castle of your heart? Have you been declaring the excellencies of the one who transformed you from darkness into marvelous light? Has it been? Does the cardboard cutout tell that story? Or is it more than that in your life? Remember that you were at a time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, through the gift, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Jesus. For he himself, he is our peace. He has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility, so that you are no longer strangers, you're no longer aliens, you're no longer enemies, but you're fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. Wow. You who had a tremendous, me, the one who had a tremendous debt of sin hanging on our shoulders, he has wiped our slates clean. Declaring that there has been no trespass of sin. He's disarmed any ruler and all rulers and authorities. He's put them to open shame, triumphing over them through the cross and now through the empty grave. Today the gift is here. Jesus Christ is his name. Isaiah 62 says this, "The nations shall see your righteousness and all the kings your glory. You shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give you. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord and a royal diadem in the hand of our God. You shall no more be termed forsaken, and your heart shall no more be termed desolate. But you shall be called the Lord's delight, for he himself is now within you, and the Lord delights in you." Guys, for maybe the first time ever, you have to know that the God of all the ages said this about you. Put your name in there. Instead of singing it only about Israel as the carol orchestrates, place your name in that place. He has ransomed you. He has redeemed you. He has called you by name. He wants to offer you the gift of eternal grace and salvation, pouring those rich streams deep out into the wells of your own life today. Yet we sing the song, we read the verse. Do you know that the Almighty has said that about you, about me? It ought to transform us in a way the world has never seen, in the way that we have never experienced. There are no special waivers or favors with this gift, my friends. There is no special Christmas sweater required. There is no special part to play or style to prepare for. You can come just as you are, just as you are. But please know, when you come and when you make room in your heart for him this year, it may set you apart. Also know there is another profound truth about this gift that will never disappoint. It will never be trumped by any other dream of this world. While the world and others around you may call you a fool, and you may not be understood by members of your own families, making room in your heart for Jesus this year will open your eyes to the hope and promise that is found in this gift as has never been experienced before. From darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God, that you may receive the forgiveness of sins and a place among those who are sanctified in Him. That's the gift of Jesus. The giver of the gift says this to you and to me. I will put my own words. I will write it on the tablets of their hearts. I will be their God and they shall be my people. They shall know me from the least of them to the greatest of them, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and I will remember their sin no more. Is there room in your heart for God to write His story? You can come just as you are, but know that it may set you apart. When you make room in your heart and trade your dreams for His glory. Galatians says this, when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth His Son, born of a woman, born of the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons and daughters of the Most High God. Friends and neighbors, based upon the authority of the Word of God, the manual of truth for this gift that we have been offered, God's desire, we can read and know today, God's desire is that no one would die without this gift. And so we can also safely and authoritatively declare that the fullness of time has come for every single person in attendance here today for you to receive this gift. There is no better time, friends, to receive the gift than right here and right now. The Spirit of His Son, Christ Jesus, is requesting entrance into your heart, allowing you to cry out, Abba, Father. So you will no longer be a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. Formerly, when you did not know God, you were enslaved to those that by nature are not gods. But now that you have come to know God, or rather be known by God, how can you turn back to the weak and worthless elementary principles of the world whose slaves you want to be once more? Are you kidding me? Why would we want to continue that repetitive cycle, leaving us empty over and over and over again, Christmas after Christmas, going through the motions, going through the cycle, and finding us empty, an empty room in our hearts? Friends, I'm seeing a lot of blank stares. This is a glorious truth that ought to awaken our hearts in ways that we have never experienced before. Why would we want to go back to what we did to 2022? There were probably great and wondrous moments there. 2023, I'm in the right place. Why would we want to revisit everything that happened back then and repeat it all over again? Yeah, we have photos. We've put stuff on Facebook that tell of wondrous things, and those are great. We've seen some wonderful things. We've been a part of some wonderful things. But why desiring to repeat the cycle that leaves us empty again this year? Friends, that can change. The gift is here. Arise and shine. Your light has come, the Bible says, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For even though darkness seems to be covering the entire world, and thick darkness the peoples who dwell therein, the Lord will arise upon you, upon me, and the glory of the Lord will be seen through us, in them, or to them, by them rather. The Bible says this, violence shall be no more heard in your mind, in your life, nor devastation or destruction within the borders of your heart. You shall call the walls of your heart salvation and the gates of your heart praise. The very peace and presence of Christ Jesus, friends, will stand guard at your heart's door in ways that are indescribable in human terms. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency, all contentment, in all things, at all times, you may abound in every good work. 2 Corinthians 9:8. I came across this in a devotional this past week. Imagine the grace Mary and Joseph needed when the joy of the betrothal gave way to the shocking news of Mary's divine pregnancy. Soon they felt the shame of cynical whispers and skeptical glances. Then the census journey required that 90-mile trek from Nazareth to a crowded Bethlehem, where they couldn't even find a comfortable room for Mary's delivery. The contractions hit, the groans of pain echoed through the stable walls, and then a baby's cry sounded out through the night. Blankets and hay received the Savior. She cradled him tight. With mouths wide open, they beheld him. God carried them through it all. Reliving the wonder of that story reminds you and me that nothing, or ought to remind you and me, that nothing is impossible with God, and that His grace is more than sufficient for my weaknesses and difficulties. His grace is greater than your weaknesses and your difficulties too. In my Father's house are many rooms. He supplies the exact amount of energy and endurance, peace and poise, wisdom and wellness needed for this moment right now. Not next week, not tomorrow, not even tonight, but for the moment right now. And He delights, friends, He delights to provide all that we need at just the right time. Just as Mary, the chosen mother of Jesus, did on that first Noel, holding the gift of the Savior tight from this time forth and forevermore, with Him dwelling within the room of our heart, friends, every wrong can be made right. Even though tears may still be experienced in unexpected situations, we may still encounter, the road that leads to glory will never be closed or out of operation. The gift that is offered to you today never slumbers, never sleeps, never quits, never grows tired or weary. With this gift in the room of your heart, the burdens that you once carried can be enlightened. The way that you once traveled can become easy. The reason the Son of God has appeared is to destroy the works of darkness in your life. For even in the desert, He makes a way. Even in a dry and thirsty place, He offers refreshing springs. Remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Living, breathing human beings. Do you perceive it? Do you see it? He is making a way in the wilderness for you and for me. Today, the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of Christ Jesus, Emmanuel, is seeking to dwell within your hearts. Oh, the depths of the riches and wisdom of the knowledge of God. How unsearchable are His judgments and how inscrutable His ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been His counselor? Who has given a gift to Him that He might be repaid? For from Him and through Him and to Him are all things. To Him be glory forever and ever. Amen. And they shall be called the holy people of God, the redeemed of the Lord. And you shall be called sought out, not forsaken. The Spirit of the Lord is here among us, Emmanuel, releasing captive, setting prisoners free, bringing sight to the blind, comforting those who mourn, granting those who have a headdress of ashes now a headdress of beauty. Oil of gladness instead of mourning is His exchange. A garment of praise instead of a faint spirit. You shall rise up and be called oaks of righteousness, Isaiah says. Everything inside of us, our common sense flesh, says this isn't possible. How can this be? But the Hebrew writer says that we ought to have hearts that are grateful and glad because we have received a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Let us therefore, the Bible says, offer to God an acceptable worship with reverence and awe, as the song sang this morning, bow at His feet. You mean, as the Apostle Paul wrote in ages long ago, that room in our hearts, making room in our hearts for this Jesus, for this gift, this Christmas, will seem like foolishness to many in our world. And we ask ourselves these questions here this morning. You mean if I let Jesus into the room of my heart, these dreams of riches and fame, they'll maybe have to be tweaked, changed, or taken away? You mean letting Jesus into the room of my heart means the decorations, the attractions might have to change? You mean letting Jesus into the room of my heart means my priorities, values, and what I spend my time on might have to be tweaked? You mean letting Jesus into my heart this year might truly transform my life? That's right. Let's look at the example himself. He went from a throne to a manger, from dazzling riches to a place of poverty, from a throne to no place to lay his head. Jesus went from a place of glory to a place of scorn and shame, hanging by nails on an old rugged cross. Jesus went from the luxurious shelter of heaven to a cold, dark, lonely tomb. And the world looked at that tomb and said, "No dead man will ever walk again." And the common sense of the world spoke forth that day, said, "See, I told you so. He's not who he said he was. If he was, he would have saved himself, right?" But the greatness and the power of this gift will not be, could not be, and will never be surpassed or suppressed by any power or threat. For out of the grave there arose that glorious day, the King of the world, Jesus Christ is his name. He forever defeated death and its evil hold upon our lives. And he seeks to dwell within the room of your heart this year. He is the one, the only one, who is able to establish our hearts blameless before God our Father. Friends, is there a room in your hearts for Jesus this year? We sing the song here different times throughout the year. We mentioned it in men's prayer breakfast yesterday morning. This gift is the way maker. He's the miracle worker. He's the light in the darkness. Will he find room in your heart this year? Jesus said, "I'm going to prepare a place for you. In my Father's house, there are many rooms. If it wouldn't have been that way, I would have told you. I wouldn't tell you a lie, right? I'm going to prepare a place there for you." And that place is not actually just a room as we know it today, but it's actually a mansion. I'm going to prepare that place for you. And I'll come back again, and I'll take you there so that you can be with me in that mansion on high forever and ever. But this one thing is required. As I go to prepare this place for you, this one thing is required for you down here. My spirit needs to be left, needs to dwell within the room of your heart. While we can't touch him, we can't see his physical presence here with us today, the Spirit of Christ Jesus, the gift of Christmas, seeks to live in your heart today. Perhaps this is just another Christmas message. Perhaps it's a glorious awakening to the truth of the gift. Perhaps it's an affirmation to what you've already believed and known. I ask that the Lord Jesus uses his word to bring victory, to bring glory, to bring peace, to bring love and transformation into your hearts again. There's a song that comes across Christian radio waves numerous times throughout the year. Tell your heart to beat again. Today, the Spirit of Christ Jesus is granting you the power and the privilege to open up the door of your heart and to tell it to beat again. Through the Spirit of Christ Jesus, your heart can beat for him. So is there room in your heart for Jesus this year? We're going to play a song by Casting Crowns. It's just a song of challenge, song of question, song of examination. You seek the Lord. Perhaps today is the very first time that you fall on your knees before him. As the shepherds did that wonderful night, falling on their knees because of the glorious light, perhaps the Spirit of Christ Jesus has shown into your hearts in a way that he never has before. Today is the day to allow him to enter into the room of your heart. Perhaps it's just a renewal, a recommitment to what He seeks to offer and give to you this year. So will you make room in your hearts for Him this Christmas? Lord Jesus, I pray that You might just speak to our hearts as this song plays. Heavenly Father, I pray that as the truths of its words and as the questions that arise in our hearts and minds from it rise to the surface, may Your Spirit help us to encounter them, sort through them, and to deal with them as You desire and ask of us. Lord Jesus, may You be glorified in this place and in every heart here today. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Listen to these words.
A family hiding from the storm found no place at the keeper's door. It was for the